you so much for having us. We're very excited to be hosting this session today. So welcome everyone for today's session on failure files, where we're going to be discussing what it means to fail in the context of social impact. We have an incredible lineup of speakers, Huda, Mahesh, Garima. Thank you all for being here. You know, I think now is actually a really timely opportunity to be having this session, because I think the pandemic has in many ways laid bare so many failures of our systems, of our leadership, of society. And those of us that work in the social sector know this better than anyone, because our customers, the communities that we work with, have actually borne the brunt of many of those failures. So the idea with today's session is really to kickstart an open dialogue around the importance of speaking about our failures, as well as what needs to change in order to create a more supportive environment to have these conversations. So to get right to it, I think I'm just going to call out the elephant in the room, which is that it's really, really hard to talk about your own failures, right? So I think it's painful when we don't meet the objectives we set for ourselves. It's also incredibly painful to worry about how our funders are going to react to our own failures, how people might judge us. But I think all of us realize that failure is actually the greatest teacher, and that there can be no innovation without it. And recently I was in conversation with Ashley Good of Fail Forward, and she said something very interesting about the context of our work specifically, which is that perhaps we are obligated to reflect on and to speak about our failures because of what is at stake. So for instance, if you are an FMCG company that has a product launch fail, the consequences will be very, very different from livelihoods program failing or government systems failing. And I think if we can begin to look at failure as an opportunity to iterate and to learn, and as something that we owe to our customers and to the communities that we work with, we'll begin to have a very different conversation about it. So today we're hoping to begin that conversation. And to do that, I'd like to introduce our guest today. So we have Mahesh Yagnaraman. He is the India Country Director at Acumen and has been so since 2018. He has been an entrepreneur, CEO, and a strategic professional for the past 30 years. And prior to joining Acumen, Mahesh co-founded First Energy Private Limited, which is an alternative energy business, and he led its transition from a division in an MNC to an independent company. It was also one of the most successful alternative energy companies in India and was later acquired by Thermax Limited. He's also worked at BP, Castrol India, and in multiple roles across Unilever in India, as well as other parts of the world. Mahesh and sort of Acumen, Acumen Academy is one of IDR's core partners. We actually co-conceived an initiative called Failure Files together, and the idea is to have more of these open conversations around failure. Thank you, Mahesh, for being here with us today. Garima is our next speaker. She is a United Nations and Forbes recognized social entrepreneur in public health. She's the regional head Asia for strategic partnerships at Medtronic Labs, where she oversees the expansion of all their social businesses through government and large-scale institutional partnerships. Previously, she co-founded a social enterprise called Svada that was driving an unorganized rural wash market to a solution-driven organized sector. Garima is also trained as an economist and has more than 13 years of global experience in impact measurement, strategy, and business development. Garima has also written a wonderfully courageous article about her failures as a co-founder at Svada. And if y'all are interested, do check it out on IDR. And then, of course, last but not least, we have Huda. Huda is a product, service, and systems designer with a keen interest in user-centric design, specifically for sustainability and development issues. She has been critical in building the various processes necessary at Selgo Foundation that have led it to becoming a pioneer in the field of building the ecosystem for sustainable energy access for the poor. She has an undergraduate degree in design from Srishti School of Art, Design and Tech in Bangalore, and a master's from MIT. Selgo Foundation is also a core partner of the Failure Files Initiative, And Huda and Selco Foundation has actually been doing a lot of thinking about failure in the context of their own organization, as well as more broadly within the sector. And I'm looking forward to getting into some of that as we begin our conversation. So just to recap, before we start, I'd just like to say that the session is about 55 minutes, and there will be 10 to 15 minutes towards the end that we will leave for questions. But of course, over the course of the session, please feel free to put your questions in the chat box, and we'll try to get to them later. Great. So I think to begin, I'd love to hear from all three of you on what you consider to be failures in your own work and why. And maybe we can start with Mahesh and then Garima and then Huda.
Thanks, sir. Thanks, Rajita. Thanks for this opportunity. I think the first thing I want to say is that when you say 30 years, you can imagine the failures are many, actually. So it's quite daunting, actually, to think about that and list down. But I think I can try to categorize them into, for ease, three kind of buckets. One is business decisions and failures around that. Second is people decisions and failures around that. The third is self decisions about myself, which are failures. And I can say that there have been failures on all three accounts, significant ones. And haven't had the courage to talk about it before this, and I must admit that. So in terms of organizational failures, I can talk about my own enterprise, which I ran. And there were some significant failures. And the first part of our work was working on the consumer market, where we were giving cookstoves to a lot of rural, semi-urban and rural population. And I remember those days we created a very successful women's entrepreneurs channel, and around 3,000 of them we could actually deploy, and they were earning at any stage between, I'm talking 15 years back, a mean median income of 7,000-8,000 rupees per month. So we were making a big difference. And I'm saying this in the context of there are a lot of organizations even today trying to tap into women entrepreneurs in rural media and still talk of a number far lesser than that. So it was a great success. So it was one of those things we were so scared of that it was successful. And as it happens, when that business didn't go forward, I really felt that we failed. We failed the women. We failed so many of them who had actually built up income for a period of time, almost 2 years. That means they had to go out of it when we couldn't continue that business. It's a specific aspect of it which I'm highlighting because it also had a lot of personal element of knowing these women and how much we made a difference, and they failed and we failed. And I recall going back to talk to some of them and almost to say that, sorry, we are moving out and what support you need. And I was so encouraged to say that they all actually felt that while this is not going to continue, this was very gracious of them. That they have learned how to make money and how to earn income. So learn something else, though this business from which they were earning was not going to be there. So that actually just made me more humble about the whole thing, but couldn't take away the fact that we failed them. I think I just carry that a lot on me even today whenever I think about it. There are a lot of other business failures, but this one matters a lot to me personally. So that is one. Other than that, there are always decisions about whether you want to launch a product and whether you did the right thing or you should have launched and you didn't launch. And there are countless examples of that. So I think that happens all the time in a business. Second one is about people. That happens in many ways. One way is that you really think that there are some people who are going to develop and become very senior, and you invest a lot in them, and you think that they have totally aligned with you, and you are kind of giving them the raises, you are giving them the right opportunities. And at the right stage, after everything is done, you talk to the board, you get them through to the next level. And next week they come and say they want to leave you. And you feel that this is a failure. And it happens quite often. And the failure is not, again, because they have failed you. It's because I have not understood enough their motivations in terms of what I thought it was. So that's the way I can rationalize it later. But at those times, they are serious failures because you really lose the face. You have backed up some people and they walk off. I think that is one. And also working with people, I also would say that I've had a fair amount of challenges along with my co-founders in my enterprise. And I didn't handle it well at all. Many times when those discussions become difficult, it's quite often about who's right and who's wrong rather than actually trying to see from the other shoes. And it's a phenomenal dynamic which happens in co-founders as against anyone else. It doesn't happen amongst colleagues. It's very ironic that when actually things are working well, you may be saying a lot of things, but when things don't work well, and people who have walked with how differences creep up. And then at those times, so often you are spending your time trying to prove you're right. And I have had my share of failures with the co-founders, and I'm sharing that openly, that many times I failed them by being very adamant about what I thought was right. And yeah, that's in a way the third part about self, I'm saying. So many times maybe I was too ahead of it, thinking that I could do this and I could build this organization at every level. But I think I was not right person at every level. I was probably right at certain stages of the organization growth, but there are other stages where I was not the right person to lead the company. But I didn't know that. And I kept thinking that I can go at various stages. So I think these are three things I can think about from my personal perspective. Yeah, I can share more as we go along.
Thank you, Mahesh. Thank you for speaking so honestly about this and using this platform to actually speak about it for the first time. Garima?
Great. Thanks, Rajita. Hello, everyone. So I think on my front, if I can just take the liberty for a minute, just to define what I consider as failure, because I guess we use the word failure very generically, and I'm particularly interested in this subject. So maybe I can just take a minute and then share the experiences also, which I have shared before, but I think this is a great platform to share those experiences again. So I think the way I look at failure is just like we pick up two scenarios, right? One scenario is that there is a problem statement in your organization, and we sit down and we look at multiple options of what would work or what could be the alternatives. We try a few of them. We may fail in some of them, but we eventually figure out the right path for ourselves. So to me, wherever we fail there is not really the failure. It's really active learning is what I would call it. Because that's how we, because that active learning is necessary for success. All of us who are sitting here talking or listening, contributing into the discussion, I'm sure have seen successes in your life at some point in time. And each of those successes would have a journey of active learning behind it. So I think I can vouch for it. None of these successes would have come small or big without some of those active learning. So that's what I would not categorize that as like true failure, but that's really active learning, which is really necessary for us to reach any level of success. The second scenario is we have a problem statement or a work thread, which we are trying to explore again at an organization level or personal level. But for certain assumptions, presumptions, perceptions, we just decide that we are not going to go that route. So we don't even reach that level of exploring options, acting on some options, failing, and then deciding what is going to work, what's not going to work. And then later on, we realize as an organization or as an individual that, oh, but that work thread was actually going to have a lot of opportunities and it would have given us some ROI eventually. To me, that is what I consider as a failure of an organization or of the founders or whoever is the decision-making power, because we did not even explore what is out there for us to fail or to succeed. Just taking an example, right? So maybe I can take a quick example on active learning and then a more concrete example on the failures. So just in my organization that I'm working with right now at Medtronic Labs, you know, it's a social business backed by a global corporate called Medtronic. Couple of months back, we had taken a leadership decision to explore aggregators in our space, in the public health space. So aggregators who can help us reach to the market better. So reach to larger institutional partners, reach to governments, right? Because I believe we all understand that this whole space of development sector is not that straightforward. You need to have the understanding of how to reach out to larger institutional partnerships. And so we did a work of, you know, figuring out, choosing which aggregator is there, doing some due diligence the way we thought it would work, and selected a partner. Long story short, about 4 months down the line, that huge investment partnership failed because it seemed that the aggregator partner was not convinced about our solutions themselves. So if they're not convinced about our model, how can they sell it outside, or how can they even get into partnerships? And the working style was absolutely different, and we were just not aligning on any levels. So to me, this is for a, you know, like a short example of active learning, because in that process, yes, we failed. We so-called wasted some of the bucks of the organization, but we got really valuable learnings of what we need to do when we're going to go next into any type of partnerships, research partnerships, implementing partnerships, institution partnerships, funder partnerships, and what not to do. Quickly coming to an example of failure, and this is, you know, again, what I would say, picking up from Mahesh's thread on co-founders, I think, again, all of us could resonate a lot to that, because having issues with co-founders, with core team members, I think is a part and parcel of being an entrepreneur. So to me, the failure, I'm going to take an example of Swadha, was that at a stage when we were about 4 years in that organization, Swadha was doing super well. From a commercial point of view, we were about to break even, we were about to get equity investments. But somewhere down the line, I was very clear that we were still not making the impact for which I had started this organization, just because the nature of model that we have adopted. And I was pushing the board to say that, let's just take a pause for a year and revisit how we want to refine our model, change our model, or maybe just do something very different to get to that impact. For some reason, you know, my co-founders and, you know, reasons are something that we can have a whole lot of conversation separately about, and the board just did not want to take that risk. So that risk appetite of taking a pause on the sprint that you are on, and the sprint is really giving you a great ROI, was not there. And eventually, again, long story short, about 6 months later, I decided to move on because my heart was nowhere there, right? Because it's not the impact that I was seeing, and the company was already doing well commercially and could have been handled by anybody else as an ex-runner. So to me, that was really a failure, not of the board, not of just one person, but together. It was a failure of me and my co-founder, failure of the board, of the organization in totality, to not have considered that and moved ahead with a much more potential of higher success. So I'll just pause there. And yes, as Mahesh also said, I think we have lots of stories to share, but we will do that in the course of the conversation. Thank you.
Sorry, I was on mute. Thank you, Garima. You know, I think the thing that sort of underlying what you're saying is also that there are so many variables at any given point in time. And oftentimes we don't even consider that when we think about failure in terms of how many different players were involved, decisions were involved, choices played a role. And I think that becomes important in our conception and understanding of when we failed, when we're actively learning, and so on. So thank you. Huda?
Thank you. Thanks so much, Rachita. Thanks for having me. And I'm glad to be on the panel with both Mahesh and Garima. And you could see me smiling at certain points because I couldn't relate more to a lot of what they were saying and what you were saying. And, you know, similar to both of them, this is a topic that's very close to our heart. It's very close to my heart. And, you know, but let me start off very, you know, candidly saying that, you know, till now, people have just been smashing successes. You know, I have not seen effective learning from failures or talking about failures in the sector happening at all. You know, and even if it does, it becomes a bit cliche. You know? So, you know, just to come out and say that, let's not make it a cliche. You know, let's make sure that we actually get somewhere with the conversation on failures, right? And I think when you were earlier talking about it, I mean, you were earlier talking about who actually fails when a failure happens? You know, whose failure is it? And back in 2018, as you were saying, you know, we did this impact failure conference, and we had Wilson Deswara, who works with Safai Karamcharis, talk about this entire elaborate, you know, episode of where you're fighting for the rights and working on solutions for Safai Karamcharis. And at the end of this really long ordeal, where there were multiple learning points and failures, and you know they were in the court, and he says he looks back to the Safai Karamcharis sitting in the court. He couldn't understand much of it, right? And they were like so, you know, hopefully looking at him like, what happened? Like, did we win? Did we not? And I think when you said earlier on who fails at the end of it, it's no one fails except for the court at the end of it. I think you know, if we can hold ourselves to NGOs, government, civil society, and bodies, you know, to really come out with documents and open conversations on failures, because it is not our failure. I mean, yes, we all fail, but at the end of it, it is the poor who face the brunt of the failure, and it is the failure of the poor. So I think it is some, which is why, you know, we hold this really dear, and we really kind of would want to, you know, work together with all of you and see how do we push the needle and the boundary on talking about failures. Like both of them, we have failed a lot more than we have succeeded. I think, I don't know if it's like both of them, but like 95% of the time, I think we fail a lot. So it could be that we're just really bad at our work, or that the problems are that complex, right? So I think, you know, we are similar to how, you know, Mahesh was describing. We also sort of categorize failures into three different buckets. One of them is more kind of operational failures, right? And that generally happens, you know, because of inadequacy of the right kind of human resources, timelines, financial kind of resources. So that generally we bucket it under operational failures. And those are very common. And I think everyone faces that. It's generally the people, time, resources, those kind of, you know, failures, right? The second bucket of failure that we categorize is more on the process level failure. So here, what we actually, you know, why that generally happens is if we've not designed structures and processes to be adaptive enough or to be flexible enough, right? If we've not designed processes, then you see these smaller parts of processes really failing. And it may not be time, resource, people, but really the design of the processes and the structures per se, right? The third, and I think the most important and critical kind of failure that have been most productive for us is failures on more like at a more model, strategic, and conceptual level failure, right? Which essentially that has happened whenever there is kind of an inadequacy of understanding a certain problem, the nature of the problem, the complexity of the problem, and really kind of the aspiration that we benchmark ourselves towards, right? So that's the third bucket of failure, which I think is one of the most powerful, but the least talked about, you know, just in terms of the buckets of failures. And, you know, I can go on and talk about the kind and number of failures. And I think when Mahesh mentioned cook stoves, there was like a big smile on my face. Like I was, you know, one of those people who really believed in like cook stoves, and specifically, you know, metallic portable cook stoves could really solve it. And I was lucky to get the, I don't know, again, I feel like maybe it was a very unnecessary kind of inefficient non-transfer and learning that we did, but I was, I don't know, I had the flexibility to get time to fail in it, you know, time and the luxury to fail. It's not something that everybody gets, I think, right? To actually, you know, may do it, you know, fail at it, do it, try it, learn. I think that's very uncommon, the, you know, environment that we get. And I think after 2 years, it was pretty sad, like, because we started with an evaluation of these cook stores 3 years later to the program, fairly large program, distributed quite a lot. And we realized that, you know, neither was it impacting, you know, cooking or women or any of those parameters. The problem itself had fairly evolved. So it was, you know, similar to that, we've had failures in integrated energy centers and mini grids, and we've had failures in actual models of dissemination models of distributors versus, you know, franchise models. And there are some of them that we've captured on the Impact Failure website, impactfailure.org. So, you know, we can speak more about that, but I'll stop there for now, and I look forward to kind of engaging in this. Thanks.
Thank you, Huda. I think, you know, as you were talking about sort of the third kind of failure, which is understanding the complexity of the problem, it reminded me of this quote by Einstein, where he said, if I had 1 hour to solve a problem, I would spend 50 minutes or 55 minutes thinking about the problem and 5 minutes thinking about the solution. But you also spoke about sort of how the social sector has only had smashing successes till now. And, you know, I think that speaks a lot to the ecosystem in which we operate. And of course, there are internal barriers to speaking about failure and kind of bringing your learning from underground above ground. But of course, there are also external factors as well, right? There are perceived risks, especially if you're a social entrepreneur or a nonprofit organization. And speaking about your failures publicly could impact future funding. It could impact current funding, brand, and so on and so forth. So, Mahesh, you know, as Acumen, you deal with a vast variety of entrepreneurs. And I was just curious to know, what are the different patterns or trends that you see among your portfolio organizations or other entrepreneurs that you've met when it comes to speaking about their failures? I know Huda spoke a little bit about what, you know, what she's seen in terms of general trends. If you could speak to that.
Yeah, that's a wide canvas to cover for me from a human perspective. I'll try. See, I think first of all, I want to say that as an investor now, if we are talking as Acumen as an investor for a moment, I am coming and talking about it. I'm not saying no one else would, but I would like to see at some stage there are more investors who are willing to come and talk about failure, than we do fail a lot. And I can talk about two ways we do, and it's difficult to talk about this very publicly. And I want to come to handle that aspect also. And the same thing happens for enterprises and companies and when they have to talk about failures. Because I think there is this notion of failure and success being the opposite one specific point, right? You want to hit this vis-a-vis hit that. So when you perceive it like that, you have a big challenge in accepting a failure, because the moment you do that, your model is seen as wrong. You are not investable. And if you are an investor, you won't get LPs backing you, everything. It's like a chain, right? So it's very difficult to talk about it like that. So you want to keep saying very nice words like, we are looking for a successful model in this space and we have invested in 3 companies. That sounds very good. What it means is, I have got 3 models in which I have failed and I'm still looking for the 4th model. I think that's what we can't say. So I'm just bringing it out how it actually the conversation happen in the space. So to be very specific, from our own experience, I can talk about one thing I see as a pattern. And then I'll go to individuals and how they come with failures to us. I think one is that one of the things we back early stage companies, very early stage companies who are starting to just prove the business model. And quite often, one thing we have found amongst all the last 10 years is that when they move from one state to another, invariably they fail, at least the first time. It's a very simple lesson. I mean, it's not very complex. But even to admit that is not many people, because typical role of an investor or anybody is, okay, I'm coming and giving you money, now expand and show it to me in more places. And people who have proved something in certain dimensions, in a certain coordinates, in a certain geography, quite often find it very hard to immediately replicate it into a next geography. Many times they fail. And it's absolutely not recognized. And I have got 4 or 5 companies in our portfolio repeatedly having this issue. So now we kind of super careful. If somebody says expand into next one, and that's why they want money or they talk to us today. So I think we are extra careful in trying to look at the model and aspects of it, which we were talking about. So that's one thing which comes to my mind. Second is, as an investor, we fund very early. So there's always this dilemma as to, if you fund them a lot, then what happens is that you're given a lot of money. That means there is a space to try and fail. One could call it like that. But quite often expenditures need to raise to meet the income or meet the funds which are there. So we have often found that it can be wasted. That is one way you can fail. The opposite side of it is, because we are early stage, we don't fund enough. We want them to prove the model in a very constrained environment so that they go and take the next round of funding. This has meant that we have put entrepreneurs at risk, because we have given them a less money. They try and they are not able to iterate quickly enough. And before that, our money has run out and they are looking for the follow-on funding. And this balance between whether they have funded it right, funded it too much or funded it too less, is a failure we often kind of confront every now and then. So I think these are things I think from an organizational point of view, a human point of view, I'm seeing it. However, I'm seeing big light. I want to talk about that. And that's where Acumen fellows come here. And we have someone like Garima amongst us, who is a human fellow. And there are people who are willing to talk about this in a brave way as it being part of the success and not just this opposite endpoint. You need to have these failures. And if you really think about it, it's nothing rocket science we're talking about. You take sports analogies, you take, as I said, if I look at my 30 years, it's very obvious that I have failed, right? But what happens is that those moments and how to talk about it is what we hesitate on. And Acumen Fellows have come up and along with IDR, I think this is a great initiative. I want to just step back and think about it. I think these are things which will bring out patterns and bringing out people to willing to talk about individual failures and then start to talk about what's the value of sharing these. And I think we need more of it. As far as we are concerned, when we look for investors, when we look for fellows, we definitely watch out if they're able to be humble enough to admit things failed. And that's the thing which actually I look for. Because if someone comes and tells me, we tried this, we tried that, didn't work, it gives me huge confidence that the people have tried it and they are able to admit that something didn't work. That means they're open to learning. And that's a big consideration for us in evaluating an entrepreneur. I am seeing it a lot. I'm not saying I won't, but it requires courage to do that. And yeah, once again, we are lucky to have some of these Acumen fellows who are very brave in trying to actually share them. And the article series, failure file series, showed some of them. So happy to be part of the journey.
Thank you. Sorry, I'm just getting a little feedback. Just give me a second. Sorry about that. So Garima, you spoke about when we were speaking earlier, as we were having conversation before the session, you were talking about sort of the business case, right, for talking about failure. I think as all of us spoke about, we said that we can all learn internally and sort of pivot and iterate and sort of alter our processes and the ways we're doing things to succeed, but to do it publicly, right? What are the incentives? And I know you spoke about your experience with Medtronic, so I'd love for you to share if you think that there is a business case for speaking publicly about failure.
Sure, Rachita. So maybe I just actually thought about it and I'll talk about Medtronic's experience, but I'll take a different example because I thought that's going to be more relevant in this context. So I would say one of the incentives, again, from the way I think about it or Medtronic thinks about it, is that, when we talk about active learning or failures, whatever that is, have a public discourse on those subjects, whether it is to do with marketing. So I'm just taking examples which are very relevant for entrepreneurs in general, right? So marketing, scale up, commercialization, partnerships, etc. Somewhere the incentive is also that you are not posing, you're not going to the publicly and talking about just the failure as a standalone. If we start talking about failures as an ask to the ecosystem to say, here is a problem statement, which we have tried XYZ things, we have failed in that. This problem statements remain across the ecosystem because I guess we all know that there are common threads of areas which all entrepreneurs face, most of the corporates face. And then we are looking for solutions together. Then there is a scope of saying, okay, there is an incentive for business case for anybody, whether it's a corporate leadership, whether it's an entrepreneur, whether it's nonprofit leadership, to come up and talk about those failures with a business incentive or a business case to get answers from the ecosystem, wherein we also benefit and the ecosystem also benefits. So I'm just going to take a short example wherein, so Medtronic, just for the larger groups, information is one of the, it's a global medtech leader, US-based MNC. Medtronic Labs, for which I am attached to, is the social business arm of that, which does innovates and builds social businesses in the public health space for emerging markets. Now, Medtronic Labs was initially, about 7 years back, was a division of corporate Medtronic. And we continued to fail at all levels when you talk about social business, like not being able to come up with the right model, not being able to scale at the right stage, et cetera, et cetera. At some point in time, about 3 years back, our senior leadership at Medtronic and Medtronic Labs started this public discourse within their peers. So when I say public discourse means talking to other corporates, coming up on forums and saying that this is a great idea of a corporate backing a social business and then testing and helping the space of public health, but we have been failing constantly. What is it that we need to do to get back on track? So, you know, these discussions happened and just 2 years back, actually a year and a half back, ultimately, you know, a lot of these senior corporate leaders, foundation leaders have come back and started saying, you know, we feel that you guys are not able to achieve what you want to achieve because the team is awesome. You know, you have the vision, you have the right thought process, you have the models. Because your PNL is constantly dependent on the country, on the corporate Medtronic's books, right? Because we are just a division of a corporate Medtronic. So every time there is an up and down in the PNL of corporate Medtronic regionally, the funding gets shut, the resources get shut, the leadership gets churned. And so it affects labs significantly. And we don't have our own identity as a social business, as any of you guys as a standalone entrepreneur would have and would have that control. And that's where, you know, we said, okay, seems totally logical. And the leadership fought to then and take the lead on this space. And now today, Medtronic Labs is actually a separate legal entity. We are registered as a public benefit corporation in US, and we have subsidiaries in India, Africa, and other parts of Asia. And within about a year and a half to 2 years, I can tell you the amount of focus that has come back because we have secured gap funding, which nobody can fiddle around with. It's we and our leadership who takes the call on all the social businesses and their approach. And we have been able to prove to the leadership that if we are able to come up with this kind of a structure, not only in Medtronic, but also convince other corporates, you know, just taking few names, which are all public, like J&J, like Novartis, all of them have huge foundation segments. And they all have been, I would say, experimenting with social business models because all of them understand that we want to put our money wherein we have a sustainable ROI and not just a grant-based ROI at that scale. And fortunately, we have been able to take that lead and demonstrate to that league of corporates that yes, if you have a separate social business with your vision, your gap funding secured, obviously the rest you will earn from the revenues and you'll raise equity. You can show the impact that you really thrive for. So that's the example wherein taking that risk of talking about your failures at a really senior level also, even if it's to do with corporates, helped us come up with some thought process, which made sense.
Right.
And really helped us from a business point of view.
Yeah, no, thank you for sharing that. I think my sense is that a lot of times there might be occasions where people will do that, but there might also be occasions where the incentive is not there or you wait for it as a last resort because your back is up against the wall and you really need help. So it's incredible that that leaders of Medtronic came forward and kind of reached out to their peer community to help with the failure. Huda, I kind of wanted to ask you the same question of where's the incentive for people to talk about this publicly?
Sure. Thanks, Rachita. So, you know, when we went out initially and tried to get others to talk about failures, we kind of had the same question, right? And we faced three kind of challenges. Number one is that, you know, your own failures versus stakeholder failures, like it happened because of this and that. The second was more from a terminology perspective that, you know, why would you term it as a failure? It's not a failure. There were many successes in between. There were many learnings in between. So call it, you know, road to success. I mean, I don't know, road to eventual success or call it, you know, learnings within the sector. But I think the terminology of failure had a negative connotation around it, right? So there was a lot of perception of, you know, only like very successful people can afford to talk about failures because we can't afford to lose, you know, people along the way, partnerships along the way, right? There was also something else that came up where a lot of people were not allowed to talk about the failures, right? For many, whether it's bilateral government, enterprise, like when you're discussing, it would be like, you know, this wouldn't be okay. So I think it does need definitely a buy-in from a very, like a decision maker within the entity or within the initiative to actually say that, you know, we will really get into the roll up our sleeves and get our hands dirty and get into the you know, the thing of why this has happened and what can it be, you know, how can it be done in a much better manner, right? And I think the other thing, and which probably is something that we you're trying to start with, and you know, we can sort of see what we can do together about, is people maybe ready to talk about it, willing to talk about, open to talk about it, but are there enough platforms and takers? And you know, is there a response that okay, it will make a difference? Like, you know, if a large entity comes out, if a champion comes out and says, you know, it's not about positive or negative, but where are those platforms to actually say that, okay, if I'm coming out with this, it is going to make a huge difference because the sector is going to change in this manner. And there are people looking for these kind of learnings and for these kind of, whatever you call it, failures that they can actually pick up and not reinvent the wheel, right? So while I feel like the narrative around it needs to be really strongly like shifted towards a very cool, like we need to make it cool and we need to make it like a trend and we need to make it some, and push for quality. Because while I think people are a lot more comfortable talking about operational process level failures, but if you're really going to push for, you know, larger systemic change, which is what we are all looking for, we do need to kind of push back on, okay, that's great, but how could it have, you know, create these narratives wherein, and it should become, you know, cool to do it, I think, right? It's not just about, yes, it's the end user. That narrative, I think, can be strengthened a lot more. Like, who fails finally when we don't come out with a document on failure? And how do we make it a lot more? I think that's something. But I think we spoke about this earlier on also, that all it's going to take is a few really good and strong champions to actually do it in a manner which is really effective and impactful. And I think then there is a potential to actually for the sector to follow.
Thank you so much for your optimism. I can see that we just have about 12 minutes left, but I'd just like to ask you all one question more, and then we'll hand it over to Q&A. If you had to say, pick one thing that you think your organization can do to begin to shift the narrative and normalize failure, if you will, really quickly, what would it be? Sorry, Huda.
Thanks. So one thing that we can do both, I think, better internally and externally is, you know, there needs to be maybe a better way to keep, I would say, personal issues on the outside and really argue and debate for the sake of the end user and the sector and nothing else. You know, like if we're able to create those environments of discussion where, you know, it's nothing to do with you and me, but let's try both of us to get to a better level through this conversation and discussion. I think if we can, you know, train ourselves better on creating those environments, I think we will get there much faster. So I think that's something that we've been trying to do internally and may have had mixed results with it. And I think in general, we do, I think together with you also, we're trying to sort of plan something. But in general, we do document a lot of failures. We do have a lot of workshops and sort of cross-learning sessions on why certain things failed and how they failed. But I think what we, because we're an implementation-driven organization, we also sort of follow up with that and sort of see what are the additional learnings if we are kind of getting it right. So I think that's something that, and also the kind of money that goes in, right? If that money was more failure-friendly and innovation-friendly, then I think that there's nothing like it. So I think all of those three aspects.
Thank you. With Karima and then Mahesh, if you could keep it to one thing, because I want to make sure that we get some questions in as well.
Sure. I think I'll just say two quick points. One is internally address, spend more time on figuring out what's really active learning versus the real failures, because that would really help our team understand where we are going from that. And second is externally just act on what we are preaching. So start sharing, basically get involved in public discourse on active learning failures, especially the senior leadership, because that I believe also makes the impact along with the rest of the team.
Thank you. Mahesh.
Yeah, I think I'll say it a little differently and probably contrary to what Huda is saying. I think instead of saying that it's not a personal thing, I think act of admitting failure is an act of leadership. So if we are actually saying it's take out the personal, I find that that's actually very difficult to do. At some stage, if one is not able to step up and say or step in and say into the ring that, yes, this didn't work, I don't think you'll see it. And that's what we encourage a lot within Acumen. And more than us doing it within, we have seen, as we say, these fellows who are coming and showing us actually how to do it. And that is what is encouraging for us on this journey. Externally, I would say, as an organization, we also don't do enough. So this is one of the first work we did along with IDEA that we actually put it out, and we are talking about it, and I'm here talking about it. I think this is a journey for us. I would put that as an act of leadership to do for us, and we are very early in this stage.
Great. Thank you all. That was a great way to end, an act of talking about failure is actually an act of leadership. So I'm going to turn to Q&A. We have about 10 minutes left. Mahesh, there is a question for you. In the startup ecosystem, especially in the consumer-driven products, the timing is considered very important, be it about launching the product or the right time to invest in scale. Mahesh, I wanted to ask you, if some of the failures you mentioned, one can take the learnings, but how do you deal with missing the right timing?
Yeah, I think the answer lies in the question. The timing is quite often the thing. I think the only way, I mean, as far as that specific question is concerned, it is being really honestly learning from the consumer. I think that's the only thing which can tell us. There is no other barometer. You have to listen to the consumer. When you say listen, there are several ways of listening, not just listening to what they say. And there is a famous saying, listen to what they do, not just what they say. They may say something, but what are they actually doing? I think really being close to that is the only way we can do. And despite everything, the timing may be wrong. And I think you have to learn that quickly and iterate. I think iteration being fast after that, from that loop of learning, is the only way I can probably, I may not be giving a satisfactory answer, but you can't get the timing right. To say that itself is I think difficult actually.
Thank you. We have another question that speaks about the perception of entrepreneurial failure being quite different in countries like India versus more developed economies. So what can be done to normalize failures and instead highlight the learnings that they present? And I think this might be a question for everyone. So whoever wants to take it, please go ahead.
Maybe I can just chime in on that. I think, you know, having being exposed to both the developed country versus India's environment on entrepreneurship, I think the only reason why in so-called developed economies it's more acceptable is because there is a whole lot of discussion publicly happening about it. And hence, since the discussion is happening freely, and that's to Huda's point, where are those forums to talk about? The more you talk about it, the more the ecosystem, whether it's media, investors, entrepreneurs, get normalized to that space of failure and accepting that failure is necessary for success, and actually not looking at it in the wrong light, but looking at it in the right light of leadership, as Mahesh said, right? And then really using that as a decision-making tool to decide where I should put my money, who has been more thorough with their failures and are open about talking about it. So yeah, I think we really need to start talking about it in a more structured manner, and then impact the ecosystem accordingly. It's like, you know, sanitation. Before Swachh Bharat, nobody wanted to talk about toilets, right? I'm just sorry, but I'm just taking that example because I was needing Swadha. The moment Swachh Bharat came with so much awareness, like Swachh, sanitation became cool. Toilets became cool. We have companies whose name has toilet in its name. And people who are ready to talk about failures, successes, what's working, what's not working, they just want to talk about toilets, whether you're failing, whether you're succeeding. So it's just, I'm just trying to draw a parallel to that.
Thank you. And you really teed me up, Garima, so I have to say this now, but with Failure Files, now there is a platform to talk about it. And, you know, and we're welcoming, we have 15 partners so far. And the idea is just, I think, like Huda said, and like Mahesh and Garima have been saying over the course of this conversation, is to just get more people talking about it. And we want to play a small role in making that happen. Last question, Mahesh, this is for you as well. While many social enterprises start with the idea of impact, it somehow gets dissolved on the growth part as larger focus is laid on the books and numbers and the eyes are on how not to fail. How do investors like Acumen react to such blurring of vision?
Yeah, it's a very relevant question. Thanks for asking. It's not, it happens, it does happen. I think we have a clear pathway on that if we can. I think if we are clear that the company is growing and it's doing well, but it has to shift out of its impact trajectory for that. I think for us, if it's very clear, it is an exit box for us. That means we will exit it. So to that extent for us, it is a clearer decision, though it may not be easy to exit. Because exits in India are very difficult, whether it's financially successful or successful impact-wise. So that's a difficult, different point altogether. But for us, that decision is a little easier. However, I think we look at it as not just a mission trip. We have to look at it very carefully because sometimes in defining that, we should not be short-sighted in the way we define. So we'll be more careful, more thoughtful. But once it is clear, there are cases like that, we definitely start thinking that at the right time we should exit that business so that they continue. It's not about us at that stage. That's the way we desired it. We also have the reverse, which people are probably not asking here, but the company may be very impact focused, but is not making anywhere commercially, right? That's a challenging thing also. There, because that's much harder, because there we have backed the impact and we want them to do financially well so that they do well and grow and scale. If it is super clear there that the model is not scalable, there also at some stage we have to call out and move out. And that we find it harder. And because of the way we kind of focus on both of them, and we know that there is a trade-off at times, we try and work for a while whether we can achieve both. But I must admit that eventually for us, it is for us to move out if we don't play a role in that.
Thank you, Mahesh. I think we're coming to the end of our time now. So I would just like to thank Sankalp again for hosting this conversation. I'd like to thank Huda, Mahesh, and Garima for such a candid and I think insightful and informative conversation. And I hope this is just the first of many. I hope that whoever is in attendance will be up there someday talking about their own failures or the failures that they're seeing around them. And if there's any way that you would like to participate in this, please feel free to reach out to us. I'm also just going to offer sort of any last words to the panelists before we close. So, Huda?
Oh, yeah. Thanks so much, Rachita. I just wanted to, you know, close by saying that, you know, unless we put the end users and the sector and the ecosystem above our egos and careers and our designations and our, you know, organizations, I think we will not find that qualitative and impactful and effective conversations on failures. So I think that's what I meant. Of course, it is leadership. Of course, it is personal. But I think just putting the end users above that to have that conversation, I think that's something which is important to really get to those more qualitative, strategic, and conceptual level failures that we're actually missing because we don't have the time, right? Looking at pandemics, looking at climate change, we don't have the luxury to, you know, put ourselves first. You know, so I think that's what I meant. But yeah, thanks.
Any closing remarks, Karima and Mahesh?
Maybe Mahesh, you want to go first?
No, you go, Karima. Let's.
Okay. Sure. I would just say, you know, 2 points again. One, strongly believe that public discourse is very limited. The more we talk, the more we will figure out what are the incentives for more people to talk about it and change the perceptions around and really get the learnings out of it. And second, I mean, I do believe that to get the people going, we have to continue to focus on what's that business case for an individual, entrepreneur, organizations, nonprofits to start talking about it. That's really the short-term view. And then getting to, obviously, as Huda is saying, looking at the end consumers eventually come into play.
Yeah, I think the cost of being repetitive there, yeah, I think that is the point here as to what is the objective of this? What is the objective of admitting failure? I mean, you're not just doing it for, I think if we are clear about it as to we are doing it for these reasons and these are the learnings we got out of it and we are able to honestly start sharing that, I think that objective will automatically lead to whether it can be seen as a useful incentive, etc. at the moment, it's a hard thing to do. Companies, if they talk about failures, the investors don't look at it. And so those are things which have to be, and they have to say, this is a failure and we have learned this and this is what we are doing. And if the investors are looking at it, I think those are kind of things which we need to, the end objective of it is to be clear. We are admitting that this is what we are learning and we are shifting based on this. I think those are small aspects of the whole thing which are required. And also at some stage being open to saying, I don't have a solution yet. And I think those are things which are part of the journey. And yeah, I think being open about it is the first step. And this is a great way to start it, start the dialogue.
Great, thank you. So here's to being more open as we close this session.